All right. Quick review. Looking at the book of Ruth, and in Ruth we learn in chapter 1 that if a famine comes on the land of Israel, which prompts Elimelech, an Ephrathite from Bethlehem and Judah, to relocate to Moab with his wife Naomi and their sons Mahlon and Chilion. Elimelech dies, and then Mahlon and Chilion, they each take a Moabite wife, Orpah and Ruth. Then after about 10 years, Mahlon and Chilion both die. And so that leaves Naomi in a difficult situation. It leaves Elimelech's line on the verge of extinction, which raises for the reader this question of what about the implied connection with David? What's going to come of that? And it also leaves Naomi in a state of having no provision or protection. So she's just in a destitute, very difficult situation. Well, Naomi, accompanied by Orpah and Ruth, she heads back to Bethlehem, having learned that God had ended the famine there, that He had provided food once again for the people of Israel. And she urges Orpah and Ruth to return. Now, she says a number of things there and says, you know, I'm not going to be able to have a son. Even if I had one today, you wouldn't wait for him. But really, the essence of her appeal to them to turn back is that she feels that God has targeted her. And I want to read to you again this comment from Robert Hubbard's commentary. He says, "Thus Naomi made her most crucial point. If even God was after her, to follow her home was to court personal disaster. Her earlier tragedies, famine, exile, bereavement, childlessness, might be only the beginning. One ought to shun such a person to escape the maelstrom of her misfortune. What better argument to make return to Moab attractive?" This is important in my looking at things, is her attitude and her perception of that she's been targeted by God. And I think that's what's going on, and we'll see that more later. Well, she succeeds in convincing Orpah to turn back, but Ruth, she won't be dissuaded. And she tells Naomi in those immortal words in verses 16 and 17 of chapter 1, "Do not urge me to leave you or to return from following you, for where you go, I will go, and where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people and your God my God. Where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord do so to me and more also if anything but death parts me from you." So you see her. We have her. She says, look, come on to come back. She gets Orpah to leave, but Ruth, I mean, she clings to her with this, you see the virtue in it. You know, it's just very, we can recognize that, and of course the Israelites recognize it. And then in 19 to 21, Naomi and Ruth, they arrive back in Bethlehem, and Naomi tells the women there not to call her Naomi. They say, oh, is this Naomi who's returning? She says, don't call me Naomi, which means pleasant or lovely, because that no longer fits her circumstance. Instead, they should call her Mara, which means bitter. And you see her spirit, right? You see her attitude that, look, there's nothing lovely about her, nothing positive going on in her life. She has, in essence, been cursed by God. Why are you going to call me lovely? She said, look, you know, why, don't do that. I left here full. I had a husband and two sons. I come back with no husband, no sons, no grandchildren. Why call me pleasant when the Lord has singled me out for calamity? I mean, He's after me. He's got the flashlight right on me. So why you want to call me lovely? I'm anything but lovely. I'm targeted. So this is her attitude. Now in chapter 2, verses 2 to 4, Ruth goes out to scavenge in the fields for food. That's in essence what gleaning is. Where, they go out into, I told you how the owners of fields, they had to leave a little perimeter around, and then they couldn't go back through the field and pick up everything. And that was so the poor could have something and the resident aliens could have something. So, but it's kind of scavenging. I mean, you're going out picking up scraps. And so Ruth goes out and she scavenges in the fields for food. And we're told in chapter 2, verse 3, the second part, that she happened to come to the section of a field. You just have these fields. There aren't fences and things, just this huge field. And this section belongs to Boaz. This section belongs to somebody, somebody, somebody. This one's Boaz. So she just happens to stumble into the section of the field that belongs to Boaz, a man from the clan of Elimelech. Now, you see, this is important. Daniel Block calls it, I mentioned last week, he calls this one of the key statements in the book. And let me read to you again his comment from his commentary. He says, the statement is ironical. Typically translated, she just happened. She just happened, you see. The statement is ironical. Its purpose is to undermine purely rational explanations for human experiences and to refine the reader's understanding of providence. In reality, he is screaming, see the hand of God at work here. And this is the same thing you see in Esther. You see, where in Esther, you don't have these express statements of, well, God did this and God did that. But what do you have? You have one thing after another, and it just so happened. And it just so happened. And it just so happened. And you're, as the reader, going, yeah, I bet it did. You see, and that's how we're to see this. You think that after, you know, he says, by the way, she has, you know, there's a relative from the clan of Elimelech. She's just out here wandering around. Where am I going? Oh, well, what do you know? I wind up in this field. So it's very important in understanding, see, the providence at work here. He says, in reality, he's screaming, see, the hand of God at work here. The same hand that had sent the famine and later provided food is the hand that had brought Naomi and Ruth to Bethlehem precisely at the beginning of the harvest and has now guided Ruth to that portion of the field belonging specifically to Boaz. So it's a very, I think, a very significant thing. In the same vein, in verse 4, chapter 2, verse 4, it says, and behold, Boaz came from Bethlehem. Okay, so right when Ruth is there, she happened to stumble on that part of the field that belongs to Boaz. Right at that time, here comes Boaz from the town out into his field to see what's going on with the harvest. Just at that time. Yes, right, Shazam, that's the word. That's the import, I think, of, you know, that's how we would put and behold. That's the thrust of it. And we ended, we were looking at chapter 2, verses 5 through 9. Okay, so all that's kind of to bring you back to where we were. Let me read 5 through 9. It says, then Boaz said to his young man who was in charge of the reapers, whose young woman is this? And the servant who was in charge of the reapers answered, she's the young Moabite woman who came back with Naomi from the country of Moab. She said, please let me glean and gather among the sheaves after the reapers. So she came and she's continued from early morning until now, except for a short rest. Then Boaz said to Ruth, now listen, my daughter, do not go to glean in another field or leave this one, but keep close to my young women. Let your eyes be on the field that they are reaping and go after them. Have I not charged the young men not to touch you? And when you are thirsty, go to the vessels and drink what the young men have drawn. See, Ruth, who happens to be where Boaz sees her, so not only does she happen to stumble onto his section of the field, he happens to arrive at that time, but he also she happens to be where he can see her. He asks about her. He wants to know what's her connection, what family does she belong to. You know, is she a servant from somebody's family? Is she somebody I just don't recognize? So we ask about that. Now, when we ended, I was making this point that it's very unlikely that Ruth, if you see here where it says here, she's a young woman. She said, please let me glean and gather among the sheaves after the reapers. Now, it seems quite unlikely that Ruth had requested and been given permission to glean and gather among the sheaves behind the reapers, as it's in verse 7, as that's translated. I mean, that indicates that what she's doing is that she's requesting and has been given permission to glean among the piles of cut grain that had been left by the workers as they worked their way through the fields. As they're going through the fields and gathering grains into bundles, then when they get too big, they'd drop them down. And then they would go on. So you would have these piles of grain. And so that was not somewhere that gleaners got to work. You didn't get to work among the sheaves because that was the harvest. You see, and they didn't want people here in the name of gleaning snatching the harvest. Okay, so you didn't really work. You wouldn't be working among the sheaves there. And as chapter 2, verse 15, which we'll see in a minute, it implies, see, that the gleaners, they normally were barred from the area among the piles of cut grain. And presumably, see, that was done to keep them from taking the harvest rather than gleaning. So normally they'd be barred from there. And so for her to come up, you know, for her to ask, let me glean among the, you know, let me glean there among the sheaves, that would be something that would be quite audacious, a very bold thing that doesn't seem to fit the portrait that you see of her is this humble, self-effacing woman. And it also doesn't fit with the fact that Boaz's instructions to her in chapter, instructions to the workers in 2:15, where there he says, you permit her to glean among the sheaves. Well, there it's presented, see, as a new act of generosity on his part. So I don't think that here that it ought to read that way. What I think is a better understanding with Frederick Bush and Daniel Block, these are two, you know, world-class Hebrew scholars, so you're not relying on me for this. Okay, with Bush and Block, I think the word there translated sheaves, it's better understood as a general sense of bundles. And the preposition, instead of taking it as among, take it as in or into. So her request was not to gather among the sheaves, among the piles of already cut grain, but to glean, to pick up the droppings, you know, glean stalks of grain, and to gather those gleanings into bundles behind the reapers. Okay, I don't know if that's, if you care about that. But when I read these things, it kind of confuses me, and I think that's the way to understand it, is that she had said, let me gather gleanings, putting them into bundles behind the reapers, not let me gather among the sheaves where I'm not allowed to go and where Boaz will later, as an act of generosity, let me go. Okay, so that's what I think is going on there, and that's how to understand that. Now, the last clause here in verse 7 is notoriously difficult to translate, where it says, except for a short rest. I think that's certainly the idea, but it seems to mean that she took only a short rest in some kind of shelter. Okay, there's a word here, the house, habayit, the house, that the ESV and a number of other translations, because it's difficult to understand how it fits, they just drop it from the text. But it doesn't really change anything, really. But I think it's some kind of shelter. The point is, though, that she worked, she was diligently working, except that she took a short rest in some kind of shelter. Now, Boaz in addresses Ruth in verses 8 and 9. He calls her my daughter. Now, this just reflects a difference in their ages. And also it reflects, I think, his intention that he's going to take care of her. He's going to have that kind of a responsibility toward her. And he tells her not to go and glean in any other field, but to remain in his field. And he tells her to stick with his regular servant girls. Okay, he's got, you know, men and women reaping and tying into bundles and doing all this kind of thing. So he says, you stick with my regular servant girls, keeping an eye on the field, they're harvesting, and you follow them. And see, that's important inside information because, as I said, you just have this huge field. And somebody needs to know where we're going. Because otherwise, you'll wind up over here thinking this is my field and it's not. So they have the inside knowledge. You stick with them. You follow them and you go ahead and you work where they are. And then he says that, he tells her that she need not worry about her situation in the field. Because, meaning as of now, see, in the very act of making the statement, he's instructed the young men, the men who work, not to, quote, touch her. You see, because he's done that. In the very act of saying this, he is now instructing them not to touch her, meaning not to trouble her, not to molest her, not to interfere with her, not to hassle her. See, he's saying, listen, I'm paving the way for you. Stick with my girls. Go into where, you know, they know where my field is. You stick with mine. I am letting the word out right now to my guys. You guys don't mess with her. Okay? You know, I'm the boss, I'm the owner, and I'm telling you, don't mess with her. Okay? So he's letting her know, listen, this is a thing of safety. And finally he tells her that she may drink freely of the water that had been brought to the field in containers for his regular field workers. I mean, that's how you do it. You know, we've got those big igloo jugs that, you know, somebody's working outside, you bring them out, and, well, that's how they would do it. They would bring containers of water, and he's telling her, you freely drink from that. No apologies, you know, you're in. You don't have to sit out here and hang on the perimeter and hope somebody throws you a cup of water. You go ahead and drink with, when the water comes, you go ahead and do that. Then in 10:11, chapter 2, verses 10 to 13, it says, then she fell on her face, bowing to the ground, and said to him, why have I found favor in your eyes that you should take notice of me, since I am a foreigner? But Boaz answered her, all that you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband has been fully told to me, and how you left your father and mother in your native land and came to a people that you did not know before. The Lord repay you for what you have done, and a full reward be given you by the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to take refuge. Then she said, I have found favor in your eyes, my Lord, for you have comforted me and spoken kindly to your servant, though I am not one of your servants. Now here, Ruth, she's just blown away. She's blown away by Boaz's kindness and generosity. And in a physical gesture of submission and gratitude, she bows before him with her face to the ground, presumably having first dropped to her knees. And then she, you know, that just, you know, that's strange for us. But this is this idea of an expression of submission and gratitude. She bows before Boaz, and she expresses her amazement that he would show her such kindness. That he would show her such kindness, even though she's a foreigner. You know, we think about that and say, well, you know, so what? But I mean, this is a significant thing. She's this Moabite who has no connection with him. And he is showing her this kind of kindness. He's treating her essentially as an equal with his hired Israelite field workers, and she just can't believe it. This is a real expression of kindness and generosity and mercy that he is showing to somebody. It's Hesed that he's showing her. He's acting on her behalf. And then he says in verses 11 and 12, he uses her question as an occasion to dignify her. He's going to exalt her. He's going to compliment her, to build her up. He uses this as an occasion to do that, explaining that he heard all about her kindness and the extraordinary commitment she had shown to Naomi. Okay, so he'd heard about it. He'd heard about this thing, and this he suggests that his action in saying that, he suggests that his action is simply because of her noble conduct, ignoring the fact he doesn't bring up that Naomi happens to be his relative. But see, he doesn't get into that, but he simply tells her. He says, listen, she's saying, man, I can't believe you're being so great to me. And he says to her, hey, you know, word's out on you. I heard all about it. I heard all about the just tremendous thing that you have done for Naomi, how you've committed yourself to her, how you've sacrificed for her. See, as soon as he was told by the foreman, he says, who's this? And he says, that's the Moabite who came back with Naomi. He realized who she was. So she's apparently the talk of Bethlehem. I mean, everybody was talking about her. You see, everybody was talking about her in a good way. They all had said, wow, did you hear what she did for her mother-in-law, this Moabite? That she said, you know, no, I'm coming with you. I don't care, you know, whatever happens, I'm sticking with you. And, you know, may the Lord do to me something bad if anything but death separates me from you. So they heard about that. You know, that's why I say that's virtue. That goes across cultures. We understand that that's noble for somebody to say, I'm going to give my life to bless you. That's what I'm going to do. And so don't try to send me away. I'm committed to this. I am going to spend my life doing what I judge is in your best interest. And that is for me to be with you. I will not leave you alone. I'm going to come with you and do everything I can to bless your life. And people heard that and they said, "Ooh, this is a character of God being expressed." You see, this is a character of God being expressed. Well, Boaz, he invokes Yahweh to intervene on Ruth's behalf. And he prays for God to grant her a full reward for this loving kindness that she's shown to Naomi. He wants God, he prays for God to grant her that reward for what she's done to Naomi. And this is in line with the principle you see of texts like Proverbs 19:17. Whoever is generous to the poor lends to the Lord, and he will repay him for his deed. So you see him taking that principle, and here he says, you have done such a great thing for Naomi. May the Lord repay you for that. May the Lord bless you because of how you have blessed Naomi. Because of that great thing you have done for her. And he then notes that Ruth had come to take refuge under Yahweh's wings. I mean, that's a neat picture, right? The image of that of a mother bird who offers her wings for protection of her defenseless young. You know, just like here they are. And, you know, he just, come on. And he says, see, you've come to take protection or shelter under Yahweh's wings, refuge. And in offering to her his protection, right? In offering his protection to her, Boaz, he was functioning like the wings of God. Isn't he? He says, you've come here to take refuge under Yahweh's wings. And what is he doing? He is extending to her protection. Right? Care. And so he's functioning in that capacity. He's functioning as Yahweh's wings, and he's honoring God in doing that. That's how we are, right? When we take on what God would have us do, we extend His care and compassion to other people. We are acting on His behalf. We are His wings and extending them out over people. And that honors God, as it says in Proverbs 14:31, "Whoever oppresses a poor man insults his maker, but he who is generous to the needy honors him." You see, so in doing that, He's functioning as Yahweh's wings and extending God's protection through Boaz. And in doing that, He's honoring God. And that, of course, goes for us as well. Now, Ruth responds in verse 13. Now, the meaning here in verse 13, the meaning, it says, "Then she said, I have found favor in your eyes." The meaning of the opening clause there in her response is disputed. Okay, how to understand it now. With Block in the New English Translation, it's not a big deal, but I think it's an expression of gratitude in which the literal statement she makes is, "I am finding favor with you." Okay, and so I think the way to take it that way, and then to just, the meaning of it is then, is, "You are kind to me." Okay, but what a lot of people do is they wind up taking it and they turn it to, "I have found favor with you." I don't think it's a big deal. But he says, "You are the essence." The meaning is, "You are kind to me," is what he's saying. Because as this one fellow Block says, taking it here to reflect past action is a rather cavalier rendering of an imperfect verb. But you get the idea either way. I have found favor. You're kind to me. You are being kind to me in saying these things. She then notes that Boaz's favor or kindness has been shown to her in that he's eased her mind about her situation. See, she was, this is not an easy spot to be in. And so he's eased her mind about her situation, and he's spoken kindly to her, his servant, adding, "Though I will never be equal to your servants." The ESV says, "Though I am not one of your servants." And I think probably a better rendering there would be with Hubbard and Bush here is that, you take the idea, no, it's a future thing. Now, the word that she uses here, by the way, Shipha, the word that she uses here for servant, this is the female servant of the lowest rank. Okay, the female servant of the lowest rank, distinct from a servant who had the potential to advance to the status of a wife. So she's basically, this is self-deprecating. She's saying, listen, even though I found favor in your eyes, for you've comforted me kindly to your servant, this lowest of female servants that you have, Even though I will never be equal to your servants. So you see her attitude. That's why I think it just doesn't make a lot of sense to me to think that she'd come in here and say, "Hey, let me glean among the sheaves." That doesn't seem to me to fit with her attitude and her spirit. And she places herself even lower. She says, "I will never be equal to your servants." And that's where I follow Bush and Block in that, and understanding that as a future rather than a present. But either way, she says, "Though I'm not one of your servants, even though I'll never be equal to one of your servants," you get the idea, right? She's saying, listen, this lowest of female servants, she is so grateful for the kindness that he's shown to her. She's blown away by it. She says, "Even though I'm like the lowest of the low, you have shown me this favor. You have done this for me." Block remarks, she says, Ruth is totally amazed that the differences in race or class could not stifle Boaz's compassion toward her. So here we have him showing Hesed to this Moabite woman who has been so kind to Naomi. And then he now is extending God's blessings and protection over her. All right, 14 to 17 it says, "And at mealtime Boaz said to her, 'Come here and eat some bread and dip your morsel in the wine.' So she sat beside the reapers, and he passed to her roasted grain, and she ate until she was satisfied, and she had some left over. When she rose to glean, Boaz instructed his young men, saying, 'Let her glean even among the sheaves, and do not reproach her. And also pull out some from the bundles for her, and leave it for her to glean, and do not rebuke her.' So she gleaned in the field until evening. Then she beat out what she had gleaned, and it was about an ephah of barley." So here we see that in verse 14, this occurs, this is sometime later. Boaz, he invites Ruth to share in the midday meal that he's providing for his workers. So this is basically lunch. So you've got people working out there. You're not only bringing them water, you're going to bring them some food out there. So he provides a meal for his workers, and he invites her to share in it. What's translated as wine here, or vinegar, or wine vinegar? It's probably some kind of sour sauce that they used as a condiment for bread. So he's telling her, listen, you go ahead and dip in that. And Boaz, he serves her personally the roasted grain. And we don't put a whole lot of stock in that kind of thing. But you have to see that, you know, in fact, is it other cultures still have these things, like when you're going to give somebody a present, you give it with two hands? Is that right? Like in Taiwan, maybe China too, you wind up that you don't give them the present with one hand. You see? Now they would understand if you're an American, you know, they understand you don't get that. But there are certain gestures and things like this, you see? And so here, the fact that he is the one serving her, well, you know, that would be a significant thing. He winds up doing that for her. See, he serves her the roasted grain, and he provides her more than she could eat. He's not being stingy about it. He's serving her, giving her more than she could eat, and he shows this foreigner, see, great compassion, great generosity, great acceptance. And you can see from her perspective how this would be like, whoa, what is this? You know, I'm this Moabite who winds up ahead of you just stumbling around on this field. Who is this dude? But he's sure taking a shine to me. He likes, you know, he's taking care of me. And so you see, you see how God is working here. 15 and 16, she rises to return to her gleaning. Okay, she'd been gleaning hard at it. Then you have the midday meal. She gets up to return to her gleaning, and Boaz instructs the workers, look, don't rebuke her, even if she starts gleaning where she shouldn't be. Even if she starts gleaning among the sheaves, among the piles of grain that are ready to be bundled, among the harvest, you just keep quiet. And by the way, what I want you to do too, I want you to be pulling some stuff out from the bundles as you are gathering up, bundling before you drop them on the ground. You know, you're cutting, gathering, drop, gather. He says, be throwing some stuff out for her. You pull the stuff out here and you be throwing some so when she goes through gleaning, she can find it. All right, well, okay, wow, this is great. There's nothing to this gleaning stuff. Hear everybody talking about you had to work so hard and hunt so hard. Look at my man, this is easy. This is like shooting, you know, fish in a barrel. I'm like, okay, well, you see what's happening is Boaz here, he is taking care of her. He is expressing God's kindness. He's extending God's wings over her in that. So she gleans in the field until evening, and then she beats out the grain from the heads of barley that she'd gotten. Presumably she did this at Boaz's threshing floor. And when she measures out the grain that she had threshed, it's about an ephah. Okay, about an ephah of barley, which is probably 5.8 gallons. Okay, now that would weigh about 30 pounds. But there's an alternate idea that it's more than that, that it's 9.6 gallons. And you have to see people who play this kind of thing. They get quite detailed. But you basically, it's probably 5.8, but you have an alternate idea that no, it's really 9.6, which would weigh about 50 pounds. So either way, you've got a ton of stuff. I mean, 30, I don't know how much those water jugs are, that are 5 gallons, but they throw me all over the place. And I can see just lugging one of those things from this field back to Bethlehem, back to the town. So whether it's 30 pounds, whether it's 50 pounds, it's an awful lot. It's an amazing amount of grain for one day of gleaning. Okay, so clearly Boaz's workers, they took his instruction to heart. I mean, they had been, you know, they'd been providing for her. She comes up, says, beats her, and wow, I'm doing okay here. All right, well, then she comes back, she says in 18 to 23, and she took it up and went into the city. Her mother-in-law saw what she had gleaned. She also brought out and gave her what food she had left over after being satisfied. And her mother-in-law said to her, where did you glean today? And where have you worked? Blessed be the man who took notice of you. So she told her mother-in-law with whom she had worked and said, the man's name with whom I work today is Boaz. And Naomi said to her daughter-in-law, may he be blessed by the Lord whose kindness has not forsaken the living or the dead. Naomi also said to her, the man is a close relative of ours, one of our kinsmen redeemers. ESV just says redeemers. And Ruth the Moabite said, besides, he said to me, you shall keep close by my young men until they have finished all my harvest. And Naomi said to Ruth, her daughter-in-law, it is good, my daughter, that you go out with his young women, lest in another field you be assaulted. So she kept close to the young women of Boaz, gleaning until the end of the barley and wheat harvests, and she lived with her mother-in-law. All right. Ruth loves this bounty that she's got, okay? Whether it's 30 pounds, whether it's 50 pounds, she lugs this bounty back to town. And when she arrived, Naomi sees the large quantity that she has gleaned. You know, she's not dense. She says, whoa, you know, things have been going great for you today. She sees this large quantity, and Ruth also pulls out and gives to Naomi the roasted grain that she had left over from lunch. Remember at 2:14? He gave her more than she could. She has some, so she says, okay, and by the way, you know, here's the takeout. So she's got more, so she pulls that out and gives that to her. Now, Naomi excitedly asked Ruth where she gleaned. And the tone is no doubt along the lines of, where in the world did you glean today? That's the tone. You see, the redundant double question, where did you work, that reflects her amazement at Ruth's success. And knowing that such bounty represented somebody's kindness toward her. Knowing that, she winds up, she adds, blessed be the man who took notice of you. So here comes, she sees this, she says, where in the world? Where have you been gleaning? Blessed be the man who took notice of you, because she understands you don't do that. If somebody's not helping you out, if somebody's not blessing you and looking out for you, you don't just go wander out into the field, be gone, and come home lugging this kind of stuff. So that's what she winds up recognizing that and saying it. Then Ruth identifies her benefactor as Boaz. She identifies her benefactor as Boaz, whose name she, you say, well, how does she know that? Well, you know, she either asked somebody, who is this dude? Or she heard people in the field talking about him. And at the mention of Boaz, Naomi, she then erupts with a request for Yahweh to bless him. And then she praises Yahweh as one who has not abandoned his hesed toward the living and the dead. Now you are seeing here the light finally going off for Naomi. You see, even when she was in her darkest time and feeling targeted and cursed by God because all of this hardship had rained down on her, God was already working and she was oblivious to it. He was working when it says, but Ruth clung to her. God was at work. God was already engineering the reversal of her emptiness, but she was completely oblivious to it. Why? Because the pain had gutted her awareness and ability to see this. Okay, now when we wind up here, the light starts going off. Hope starts being fanned. You see, she's coming out of this darkness. Out of this, just this terrible thing where you can't see anything but the hole of, I'm cursed, I'm targeted, I'm bummed, there's no hope. Whew, here's this little spark now. You see? Even though it was there before, she simply couldn't see it because of her pain. So here she says this, he's not abandoned his hesed toward the living and the dead. She realized that God was at work now. God was at work in Ruth's, quote, stumbling into the field. Ruth didn't know about Boaz. So when she heard, who in the world, where'd you get all this stuff? The dude's name's Boaz. Well, now she, that seems mighty, mighty strangely coincidental that in all the land out here, you wandered out and you just happened to stumble onto the field of Boaz. So she sees, she's seeing God's hand at work. She's recognizing that this is something that she winds up now, you know, we now have God is at work in this. She realizes He's at work in her stumbling into contact with Boaz and in Boaz's generosity to her. She didn't just wind up there with this, with the kinsman redeemer in his field, but look how he treated her. So now you start to see the lights going off. That causes her to recognize that God has maintained His commitment, His hesed, to the welfare of her family, both to her and Ruth, the living, and to the dead, to Elimelech and Mahlon. You see that? Do you see that? This completely different attitude now, in the hope that is now sparked from this darkness that she was in. You now see this. See, with a heart renewed by the hope of God's favor. You see, that's when you have the hope of God's favor that He will work to bless me. Life is completely different. Life is completely different. So this is now this is being stimulated. She has this heart that is renewed by this hope of God's favor. She seems to realize the potential that Boaz poses for Ruth and for the survival of Elimelech and Mahlon's line. So she now is really excited here. Here's what the block says about it. He says, the speech represents a total turnaround from her despairing and accusatory words in chapter 1, verse 20 and 21. Specifically in Naomi's eyes, Ruth's coming upon the field of Boaz was a demonstration of God's grace and favor. In 1, 8, and 9, she had prayed that Yahweh would match Ruth's hesed to her family by granting her rest in the house of her own husband. There she had in mind a Moabite husband, but now in remarkable fulfillment of that prayer, she is struck by the potential of Ruth's encounter with Boaz. And do you see God working? Do you see, you know, if we could see this in our lives and have some sense that, listen, there was no thunder, there was no voice, there was what? There were the circumstances of life. But God's hand was on that as surely as it was in the thundering of Sinai and everywhere else. He was at work there and she just saw it. He was at work when she clung to her, but she didn't see it. He's at work here, and now it's starting to hit her. And it's changing her life, and it will change yours. Now, that Naomi's beginning to hope along these lines, you see, it's suggested by the fact she exclaims that Boaz is a close relative, one of their kinsmen redeemers. You see, this is not just reading this into it. You can see she's thinking along these lines when she says, the man is a close relative of ours, one of our kinsmen redeemers. Now, this kinsmen redeemer is an interesting relationship. It's a term from Israelite family law. Okay, a term from Israelite family law that describes not a precise kinship relationship. It's not like uncle, aunt, that kind of thing. It doesn't describe a precise kinship relationship, but the near relatives to whom both law and custom gave certain duties toward the clan. So this is somebody who is a guardian of the clan. Somebody who has a responsibility toward the clan. You see, among other things, the kinsman redeemer, and here's what Hubbard says, quote, was responsible for the repurchase of property once owned by clan members, but sold from economic necessity. You see that in Leviticus 25, 25 and 30. You can also look at Jeremiah 32, 1 to 15. He says, by restoring the land to its original owner, the kinsman redeemer maintained the clan's inheritance intact. One of the functions, one of the duties that the kinsman redeemer owed to the clan was that if a clan member sold a tract of clan land because they were impoverished and they needed the money, he comes and buys it back to bring it back into the line of the clan so that the inheritance stays there. That's one of the responsibilities that the kinsman redeemer has. Now, the duty of the kinsman redeemer, I'm not going to have time to do this, but I'll say what I can. They're quite broad. Okay? They're wide duties. And so it's easy to imagine that their application in certain atypical situations would be unclear. I mean, that shouldn't surprise us, right? We have situations of how does the law apply in certain circumstances. So when you get the more bizarre, the more atypical, the greater the questions are about what is the right application of the law to this circumstance. And I think that's important here. I think there is some uncertainty about how does the law apply here, and I'll explain how I think that works out. But here's what Hubbard says, Robert Hubbard. He says, one must reckon with how complex... Okay, let me see if I want to read this yet. All right, you just hold that thought. I'll go back. I want to say something first. Let me say something, then I'll read Hubbard, who kind of goes along with what I'm trying to get across. Now, I'm thinking, see, that the breadth of the kinsman redeemer's duties and the ambiguity of those duties in certain atypical situations comes into play. Specifically, I'm guessing, okay, my sense of reading this, what I think is going on is that it was debatable, okay, arguable whether a kinsman redeemer who was not the brother of a deceased male, okay, you know how the Levitical stuff, the levirate marriage, it worked, you know, the classic case is the brother. Okay, I think there's some question, some ambiguity, and it's being debatable about whether a person who's not the brother of a deceased male not only had the duty to redeem the property of a deceased male that had been sold, but also had a duty to perpetuate the existence of the deceased male on that redeemed property. Not just to redeem it back, but to perpetuate the existence of the deceased male on that redeemed property by continuing the lineage through a Leveret-like marriage to the deceased male's widowed Moabite daughter-in-law. Where the deceased male's widow was alive, but beyond childbearing years. Do you see the complications that come in here now? Let me read you what Hubbard says. He says, one must reckon with how complex, indeed extreme, is the situation told in Ruth, compared, for example, to that in Genesis 38 or Deuteronomy 25, 5 to 10. These texts presuppose the relative youth of all parties involved, whereas in Ruth, the widow Naomi is old. No mention is made of Elimelech's brothers as candidates for Leveret marriage. Presumably, they, like he, are also deceased. Thus, a true Leveret marriage is impossible. Even were there a surviving brother, such a marriage would be futile, since the text implies that Naomi's physically beyond childbearing age. Hence, this situation requires stand-ins for both Elimelech and Naomi if they are to have an heir. So what I'm suggesting to you is that I think this is an atypical situation, and I think that it would be debatable how does the law apply in this circumstance. Now, I say that because what I think is going to happen is Naomi is going to assert a broader application of this law, and so there's uncertainty about whether Boaz will accept that view. And I think that accounts for the discretion with which she broaches it. You see, in other words, if this was just cut and dried law, you just go to her and say, hey, marry her, dude. She doesn't do that. There's this great discretion, you see, with all of this stuff about how she goes and, you know, on the threshing floor and all that. And I think that's designed to protect the parties in case they don't really see it the same way. I think she's trying to be as discreet as possible to avoid embarrassment to either side. So if she has Ruth coming up and she's saying, listen, no, this is the right. He's our kinsman redeemer, and this is the way it works. And so she goes there and she says, now what if he said, what, are you crazy? No, you trying to foist on me some kind of crazy reading of my responsibility? All right, well then she's going to be humiliated. Well, what if he says, no, I'm not going to accept that. And then it turns out that, well, you should have accepted it. Well, then he looks ungracious. So I think that is why she so discreetly brings this subject up. So that in private, nobody around, if it happens that they're not on the same page on this thing, well, then they can confine the humiliation. Okay? And I go through all that because you'll see as the story unfolds, I think that makes more sense of what's going on. And that's perfectly understandable to me because of the atypical situation that you're facing. So I think that's how she's going to do it. I heard that bell. Thanks for coming.